Penguin Random House Canada presents The Secret History of Soldiers, How Canadians Survived the Great War, by Tim Cook. Read for you by J.D. Nicholsen. Introduction. Soldiers' Culture. Major Maurice Pope, a 27-year-old pre-war civil engineer and a future lieutenant general, wrote that the Great War of 1914 to 1918 was a huge siege in which neither side was able to dislodge the other, adding, "It strikes me as being a test of endurance. The million-man armies kept fighting far beyond any rational period of time, as tens of thousands were killed, then hundreds of thousands, and finally, millions. For soldiers at the sharp end of battle, cycling in and out of the trenches in 1915, 1917, or even throughout much of 1918, the war seemed destined to go on forever. With the Allies and their German adversaries stalemated on the Western Front from the first months after the initial clash in August 1914, the commanders were reduced to ordering frontal attacks against the enemy's guns and defenses. They had little success beyond producing mounds of corpses. There were few obvious solutions to the deadlock of the trenches, and the only way to victory seemed to be through more of everything. More shells, more men, more carnage. The German soldiers, fortified in their deep trenches, situated on the best terrain that was protected by barbed wire and machine gun emplacements, would have to be steamrolled out of existence. New weapons, tanks, airplanes, chemical agents, and from mid-1916, millions of high-explosive shells, would kill and maim the defenders and eventually force them to give in, but not before all the armies had suffered terrible losses. This was the strategy of attrition, to kill proportionately more of the enemy than your own side lost, and eventually to force his surrender. During these costly campaigns, the infantry learned from its errors and defeats, refining tactics and training, introducing new weapons and mastering them on the battlefield to fight their way forward. But it was a bloody way to win. And so there was a crucial factor in battle that had little to do with weapons or tactics or operations. The willingness of soldiers to keep fighting. In a long and costly war of attrition, this was essential to victory, or at least to staving off defeat. The great fear of the senior commanders was that their soldiers would collapse from the considerable strain of unending combat and the grinding effects of monotonous trench warfare. Over time, those who escaped the scythe of machine gun fire and artillery shells would see their chances of survival shrinking and might run away or down arms. In that imagined scenario, soldiers, units, divisions, and eventually armies would be used up, become brittle, and eventually break. The war would be lost. The iconic images of the war are of the haggard soldiers standing at the firing line, bayonets at the ready, preparing to launch themselves into the teeth of barbed wire and machine gun fire. The bleak no man's land, the dead zone between the enemy trenches and the Allies' fortifications that was filled with rusted barbed wire and shell craters, serves as an apt metaphor for the futility of combat throughout much of the war. Amid the unburied corpses and flesh-eating rats, the cries of anguish and agony resonate. We remember helpless soldiers, men caught in a no-win situation who stumbled around like the living dead until they were put out of their misery. This is the soldier as victim. The Secret History of Soldiers offers another way to understand the Canadian soldier in the Great War. We are like the rats which infest the trenches burrowing in the ground, Herbert Burrell wrote in his diary a few days after Christmas 1916. Sleeping by day, groveling in the mud at night, mud in your bed, in your mess tin, on your food. We seldom wash. One marvels at the cheerfulness of the boys who have been out here a long time. Burrell, a pre-war artist who enlisted at the ancient age of 45, would survive the war, although he remained angry and traumatized by what he had witnessed. Millions of soldiers fought along the Western Front trenches that stretched 700 kilometers from Switzerland to the North Sea. Every day, thousands were killed up the line. But hundreds of thousands more survived. How did they deal with the appalling stress? How did they cope with the slaughter of friends and comrades? War has made me more or less callous to the suffering of others, reflected Lance Corporal Percy Charles Reed. A former bank clerk, Reed had enlisted in December 1916 at age 20 and would be awarded the Distinguished Conduct Medal for bravery during the 100 Days campaign at the end of the war. Sustained combat and holding the line for extended periods indeed brutalized men, leaving some coarsened and insensitive, but most ached to hold on to their humanity. A crucial part of the Canadian soldiers' means of coping was the creation of their own unique culture and society. Culture is the beliefs, practices, customs, and values that define groups of people, societies, and nations. Created in communities and shared to strengthen bonds and relationships, culture consists of highbrow artistic endeavors and the everyday experiences of individuals, both of which provide meaning for a group, helping them understand their collective and individual lives within a broader, constructed society. Separated from civilians far behind the battlefield, the Great War Soldiers' Society was shaped by the abnormal environment of death and mayhem at the front, and it spawned new ways of understanding in the form of a distinctive culture of music, print, and theater. In the landscape of killing, soldiers acted imaginatively and creatively, and their culture insulated and defined their group. They wrote and performed songs, poems, and plays, and produced newspapers, all of which reflected their hard lives at the front. The development of this culture was also one of the ways that soldiers exerted agency within a consistently dehumanizing war. The destructive supremacy of the war was thus met by the ongoing resiliency of those caught within it. Most studies of war and culture focus on elites, the novelists or artists who fashioned moving visual works or stirring word pictures. The British war poets Siegfried Sassoon and Wilfred Owen have been the guides to the English language Trent's experience for nearly 100 years. Painters such as Paul Nash and A.Y. Jackson, working in an official capacity, captured a profound visual record of the war on canvas. Yet the average education of the 620,000 Canadians who served during the war was of a grade 6 level, and the vast majority of soldiers would never paint in the official war art program or write poignant prose or poetry. What then comprised the culture of the mass of men who came from every town, village, and city across Canada, and all the farmland in between, to form the Canadian Expeditionary Force? The soldiers' culture, forged in the trenches and behind the lines along the Western Front, was as important to winning the war as weapons, leadership, and tactics. And it came from the soldiers themselves. It was not imposed by the generals at the top of the army hierarchy. In fact, the culture often subversively pushed back against authority. Vaudeville skits, cheeky stand-up comedy routines, and risque songs and jokes, combined with superstitions, slang, and graffiti, reveal the soldiers' desire to forge their own ways of enduring. Tom Leesk of the Canadian Field Ambulance wrote to a friend at home about his experiences on the battlefield, observing, "It is a very strenuous life and a hard game. The people in Canada have no idea, nor can any person have, unless they have been in it. The spirit of the soldiers is wonderful. They meet everything with a smile. I sometimes think that to them, death is a joke." Soldiers registered and understood the horror and trauma of the trenches in combat, but they embraced their own humanity as a way to see things through to the bitter end. The spirit of the soldiers, as Leesk described, was infused by a vibrant culture that was used to guard against the tension and anxiety of having to survive unimaginable violence. Soldiers often used dark humor as a safeguard. Sarcasm and satire helped men in uniform come to terms with the madness of the war. With its kilometers of trenches, drudgery, and death, the war on the Western Front could have sucked the laughter and humor out of those in its grip. But that was not the case. Infantryman Leslie Frost believed that the soldiers developed a good-humored tolerance of almost intolerable conditions. This sense of humor, biting, nonchalant, at times even juvenile, underpinned the fighting men's secret culture. Cecil French, who had been studying to be a missionary in India before his enlistment, shared with a friend his experience during one of his tours at the front, noting, "I've seen nothing, absolutely nothing yet, compared with the almost literal hell which most of the boys over here have been through. But they seem to be much the same boys as they were before. The human frame can become used to anything, it seems. They seem happy. They laugh at danger and joke at hardship, and they have plenty to laugh and joke at, therefore, as a rule. In a war where soldiers could scream or laugh, most chose to do the latter. There was a materiality to soldiers' culture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.